Well, a lot of the pleasures that you and I have are hardwired. We're born with them. And so they start off as early as you could imagine in young babies. And they exist because they're adaptive, because they're adaptations through natural selection. And so babies like the taste of sweet breast milk. They like being held. They like being cared for. They like having their bellies full. They like being clean. They have a set of innate pleasures that exist because they guide them to try to feed, to try to get protection, to try to get close to people. And so there's a logic to pleasure early on, which makes a lot of sense. We're drawn to enjoy the things that are to our benefit. Now, as you get older, all sorts of other pleasures fill out. And one way I like to think about it is that humans have a sort of fixed list of pleasures given to us by our biologies. The pleasures involve certain sorts of food, drink, sex, music, art, and a few others. Now, of course, cultures can create new pleasures, but typically these new pleasures are expansions of things that we're biologically primed to enjoy. So chocolate cake is a new pleasure, but it takes advantage of our enjoyment of sweets. Rap music is a new type of music, but it takes advantage of a biological preference for certain sorts of rhythm. Internet pornography is very new, but it takes advantage of our sexual appetites that start off in a much more basic state. So I think that that's a good part of the story of pleasure. But I also think there's more. And this is something which babies don't show. But for adults, and I wrote a book on this, for adults, the argument I make is that the sort of pleasure we get from things is powerfully influenced by what we think these things are. So wine tastes better if you think it's expensive. A face looks more beautiful if it's a face of somebody you love and respect. Food tastes better if you think it's fresh. Artwork looks better if you think it was a masterpiece by Picasso or Rembrandt, as opposed to painted by the guy down the block. Every aspect of our pleasure, including sort of complicated ones like modern art, but also very visceral ones like sex and food, are powerfully influenced by our cultures, by our beliefs, and by our knowledge. And this is a way in which pleasure serves as an example of how biological propensities can combine with cultural experience. There are many sources of pleasure in one's life, but one is the act of discovering something, of exploring, of finding out something new. I mean, we see that in the children who love puzzles and games and are very curious to open up something. If you ever tell a child that it's forbidden to open up this box, and then you leave the room, what he'll see the child will take a peek. And I think that there's sort of an adaptive value to being curious. It's an important world out there to know about. And a creature that's motivated to do the exploring is going to be, all things being equal, better off than one who just stays still and has no interest. Now, it's complicated because there are risks of being curious. There are risks for trying to discover things. But I think it's a fundamental human desire and a fundamental human pleasure. Among other things, it motivates learning. So a child has to learn to speak, has to learn about the social rules of the world around him or her. And to do that, curiosity helps. And then you see curiosity not only in the children and the babies we study, but in ourselves. The great motivation behind science is curiosity, is wondering what things are like. And the buzz you get from finding out, from answering a hard question. And so I think it's not only a fundamental pleasure of our lives, but I think it's a very important one.